Concept map is constructor concept, then what are the types of the constructor, and then what will be the example for the constructor. So you will, the basic key learning is you should able to know the concept of constructor, and you can write down some programs based on the constructor. First we will see the concept of constructor, then we will see the types, and then based on that particular type we will see the example. Now what do you mean by constructor? Constructor is a special member function whose task is to initialize the data member of the class, okay, whenever the object is created. Okay, now why constructor is called as the special member function? Because constructor name and class name is the same, okay. And constructor will do not have any return type. Okay, so we will just see one example, small example I have mentioned here. Class employee int a comma b semicolon. So a and b are the, a, b and salary are the data members. And how we will write down the name? As I already told that class name and constructor name should be same. So class name employee, constructor name is also employee. Now here we will just assign the values, okay, in your constructor. This is outside declaration. So employee, then scope resolution operator, employee. Now see, constructor do not have any return type. So in your outside member function declaration, before class name, what is the return type? So return type, we will not have return type. Then employee is the class name, scope resolution operator, this employee, it is for your constructor, and then void, and we have assigned a and val, a and b, a and variable a and variable b value as 0. Constructor name and class name should be same, and it does not have any return type. Now we will see when you will define constructor, right? So it will call automatically. For example, when you will create the object for the constructor, it will get automatically called. For example, employee even. So employee even. So whatever the constructor part you have written in your particular class program, that constructor part, it may be of any type, it will get automatically called. So there is no any need to write down the like your member function. Though it is a member function, there is no any need to call explicitly your constructor. Now in that employee even, if you have created, and if you have taken the reference of last example, so in that even, even whatever the even is there, so even object, okay, will which is from the class employee, and it will initialize a and b to the 0. So based on that we have some characteristics of constructor. So constructor has the same name that of the class, yes. It will get invoke automatically whenever the object of the class is created. So where you will define your constructor? Constructor must be defined in a public section of a class because it is a member function. Okay. And if you want to execute the constructor, why you will declare in public section? Because whatever you have written in public section, that you can access outside the class. And if you want to access the automatically constructor, if you want to access, then it is must you have to define outside the class. Then it does not have any return type, you cannot inherit the constructor. But in some cases, derived class can call the constructor of the base class. Okay, so that inheritance part when you will learn, you will come to know about this characteristics of constructor. Then constructor can take default values, constructor can take parameters, constructor can be virtual, and one can refer the address of the constructor. Okay, and constructor can make implicit call to the new and delete operator whenever memory is required. Now we will see the syntax. Syntax is class name, argument list inside constructor. So in public access specifier, you will write down this. So example is class student, private int roll number, char name. So student int r char name. So you can write here assignment statement. So class name and constructor name should be same. Now defining outside the class. So class name, scope resolution operator, class name, argument list. Okay. So class student, int roll number, name. Then student constructor, and student constructor will take the values of roll number and name from the user, and void put data will display the value of roll number and name to the user. So void stud, so how you will declare the outside the class? So your student is your class name, then scope resolution operator, and then again your constructor name. So we will have types of constructors. So total we have 5 types of constructor: default constructor, parameterized constructor, copy constructor, constructor with default argument, and overloaded constructor. So first we will see default constructor. So constructor with no arguments means we will not pass any argument to that particular constructor. Where you will pass the argument after writing the constructor name, that is your class name, then in open and close bracket, in this open and close bracket we will write the, we can pass the arguments. Yes, we can pass the argument in constructor, but the case with default constructor, there is no any need to pass the argument. So we will see class, student, example, int roll number, name, student, then scene roll number, name, and input data, we have just displayed the roll number and name. Okay. So again here I have mentioned one small example, class employee, int a comma b semicolon, in public access specifier we have to declare the constructor, then class name, open and close bracket, and a and b value we have assigned as a 0. Now whenever you want to do some type of assignment operation where you want to strictly initialize the value as 0, then at that time you can go for a constructor. Okay, and that constructor type should be default constructor. Now again, for one type of constructor I will be explaining you inside inside member function declaration and outside member function declaration. So this is for the default constructor: class, class name, public, class name, open and close bracket, and here we will write down the statement. So default constructor, so scope is in between, you cannot declare the outside the class, you have to declare the inside the class, you have to declare your constructor. Okay, so example, class employee, int a comma b, public, employee, so and then class is get terminated, we have assigned a and b value as 0. Now we will see outside member function declaration. So in outside member function declaration, syntax, class, class name, public, class name, then open and close bracket, and then you have to specify the semicolon. Unless and until you will not specify the semicolon, okay, so compiler will not understood that yes, you are declaring that particular constructor as the outside member function declaration. So class name, scope resolution operator, class name and statements. So example, class employee, int a comma b, public, employee, open and close bracket, semicolon, and at the time of outside member function declaration, class name employee, scope resolution operator, then class name employee, open and close bracket, and I have just initialized the value to the 0 and display the value. Okay, so in void main employee, now there is no any need to give the brackets also, only employee, he will automatically call this employee, and this then execution will go here, from here it is outside, so it will come here, it will read the value a as 0, b as 0, and it will print the value a and b is equal to 0. Then parameterize the constructor. Now in parameterized constructor, the name itself, it will tell you that yes, you have to pass the parameters. Okay, now when you want to, constructor can take the argument, that is called as your parameterized constructor. Okay, so sometimes it is required that yes, we have to pass the parameters, right? So in that case we can go for parameterized constructor. So we will see the syntax, we will see the example, class employee, int a comma b semicolon, then in public I have just declared the outside member function declaration, so int comma int, employee, scope resolution operator, employee, int a comma int b, b b, so a will assign to the a and bb will assign to the b. Okay, now in parameterized constructor, employee one, right? Now see, now what is the variation between default constructor and parameterized constructor? In default constructor you can, in void main you just write employee even, but in parameterized constructor, right, employee even will not work, you have to pass the parameters. Now how we will pass the parameters? There are two methods, okay, to call the constructor. Okay, so we will first see the implicit call. That is what automatically call, it will call in both the cases, it will automatically call, but one is implicit and another is explicit. How we will see employee E1 10, 30. So it will automatically call, it will store the value of A as 10 and it will get assigned to the A. It will store the value of BB as 30, it will get assigned to the B. But when you want to do the explicit calling, so you have to write down class name, then object name equal to sign, then employee and then 10, 30. Okay, so working will be same, but declaration, how to declare in void main, how to create the object in void main, that are different. So the program for parameterized constructor, class integer int m comma n, so class name is integer, so you will create the constructor with same class name, that is integer. Then in integer you will pass the two parameters of our data type as integer, void display void. Then in cout you will display the value of a man n. Then next we will see, we will declare here parameterized constructor, constructor declared, constructor defined. Okay, then int scope resolution operator integer int x comma int y, then m is equal to x, n is equal to y. Okay, now x value and y value will get assigned to the m and n respectively. Now first we will see implicit call, integer int 1 0, 100, so 0 will get assigned to the x, that is to the m, and 100 will get assigned to the y, that is to the n. Then in integer, integer int 2 is equal to integer 25, 75, so x will get assigned as 25 and y will get assigned as 75. And that will get assigned to the m and n respectively. So int 1 display and int 2 display will have the values of 0, 100 for int 1 and 25, 75 for int 2. I have executed with the help of dev C++. So concept map is constructor, types of constructor and example. In last learning outcome, we have learned the concept about constructor and its default constructor and parameterized constructor. Now in this learning outcome or in this presentation, we will learn copy constructor, multiple constructor and constructor with default argument. So first we will start with copy constructor. So what do you mean by copy constructor? The name itself, you want to copy, but what you will copy? You will copy the object from one object to the another, or you will copy the data member's value from one object to another. So how you will copy? So for that, as you already learned that we have implicit calling and explicit calling for parameterized member function, same logic we will apply here. Okay, so for example, complex C2 bracket C1. So this is one statement regarding the copy constructor. Copy constructor main part will be in void main. Then complex C2 is equal to C1. So in both the cases, content of C1 will get copied in content of in complex object at C2. Then next, copy constructor will copies data member. Okay, one data member, it will copy the value from the another data member, another object. Okay, so from one object it will copy all the values of data member from one object to the another. So it takes the reference, because you need to take the reference if you want to do the copy constructor, if you want to perform the copy constructor. So with the help of program, you will come to know about the copy constructor. Okay, so first is header file, class code. So class name is code, and I have taken only one data member because we have to see how you can copy the content, not what you will copy. Okay, so how you will copy the content? First we will see first. So you will have first default constructor. Okay, so in default constructor, it is why it is required default constructor? Because sometimes if you don't want to assign any value to the particular copy constructor, so you, with the help of default constructor, so you can have that you can call that object in your class. Then code int a, so id is equal to a. Then code ampersand x. So this is your parameterized constructor. So a will get assigned to the id. and code is equal to code ampersand x. So here id is equal to x dot id, means here x dot id value will get assigned to the where you want to copy. Then in display we will display the value of id. So code c1 comma 3, so 3 value you have to copy in all the objects of code c code. Okay, so code c2 bracket c1, so it will copy the c1 into c2. How it will copy, just look at here c1, it will come here, it will execute this part c1. So id c1 dot id, c1 dot id value, what is the value of c1 dot id? That is 3. So 3 will get assigned to that particular object id. So what is this object? C2. So c2 value of id will be also 3. And then code c3 is equal to 7. It is just assignment operation. All data members of c1 will get copied into c3. And then we will display c1, c2 and c3. So in c1 it will have 3 values, c2 3 and c3 also 3. Id value is 3. Next is multiple or overloaded constructor. So in multiple or overloaded constructor, what we have to do? We have to overload your constructor. So how you will overload your constructor? So in constructor, as we know that constructor do not have return type. Okay, so what you can overload? You can overload the arguments, number of arguments you can overload with the help of multiple or overloaded constructor. And when you will overload the constructor, okay, at that time compiler will identify the version based on the data type you have used. Okay, based on the parameters you have passed to the particular constructor, compiler will call appropriate version of that constructor. Okay, so if you are in your program, if you are having more than one constructor, then you can say that yes, I have overloaded the constructor. So the example is class, class name is employee, int a comma b, then public employee, this is the default constructor. Second one is the constructor with one argument. Third one is constructor with two arguments. So in a default constructor, we will assign the value of a and b as 0. In one argument, only one argument we will pass to the a and b. And in this third constructor with two argument, x and y will assign to the a and b respectively. Now we will see when you will call in a void main. At that time, suppose if you have written here employee e1. So in employee e1, it will invoke this constructor. Invoke means what? It will call this constructor and it will assign a and b as 0. Okay, and if you have display function and if you have written e1.display, then you will get the value of a and b as 0. Then in second, employee e2 of 10. So in employee e2 of 10, you will have the value of a and b as from x. So what is the value of x? 10. So a and b will be 10. And for e3, 10 comma 20. So a and b will be 10 and 20 respectively. Now next is your constructor with default argument. So in constructor with default argument, so we have to pass the default value. So where you will pass the default values? In your member function. Function declaration, at the time of function declaration, we will pass the default values. Okay. Now how it will work? We will see with example. So complex, float, real, float, imaginary. And for imaginary, we have assigned the value as 0. Okay, now when you will call that function in your void main object along with object, at that time complex 5.0. Now I have just passed here only one value, another value is missing. So at that time what compiler will do? Compiler will take the value which is from default argument, that is 0. But suppose another example is there, complex 5.0 and 4.5. So in that case it will take, already value is present, so it will take the value from this particular, from this 5.0 as a real and imaginary as 4.5. So we will see one example based on this. So class, class name is complex, private, float, real and imaginary. So these are the data members. Okay, then complex, float r comma float I 0.0. I have assigned the value for imaginary as 0.0. Okay, then real is equal to r, imaginary is equal to I. So real value which you will pass in main with the help of object, it will get assigned to the real and imaginary. Then void show real and imaginary, we will display the value. Then in int main complex c 2.3. Now when I am writing only one argument, another argument is missing. So at that time it will accept the value from the default argument, that is 0.0. Just look at here c1.show real is equal to 2.3, imaginary is equal to 0. And in complex c2, 2.3 and 3.4, both the arguments are present, both the values are present. So r will be 2.3 and I will be 3.4. So real will be 2.3 and imaginary will be 3.4. And one more thing about the constructor is that constructor take less time to execute. Just see the execution time, 0.6095 seconds. So within minute it will get execute. Okay. Now based on that, I have some assignments for you. So first is display a class fraction which has numerator and denominator as a data member. Write the constructor to display fraction. Okay, so here you have to take again parameterized constructor and you have to take numerator and denominator as a declared as a data member and you have to display the value, okay, to the user. Okay, and you have to display the fraction means what? You have to perform some operations. So in show data member function you can perform the operation, otherwise in your constructor, right, in your parameterized constructor you can perform the operation, that is a numerator upon denominator and display the fraction. You can display the fraction. Okay, next is write a class to represent bank account. Include following members: name of the depositor, account and balance amount. Initialize the value using constructor. So with the help of constructor you have to initialize the values, okay, and add the member functions to deposit an amount, then to withdraw an amount after checking a balance, and to display name and balance. Okay, so to deposit an amount we have to write down the separate member function, one constructor. Withdraw amount withdraw, you have to write down separate member function, and name and balance. Show data, you can display the name and balance. Then next one, write a program to declare a class student having data members as roll number and percentage. Write constructor to initialize this data member. Class name is student, data members are roll number and percentage. Okay, and one for one object you have to accept. So you will pass the value like student S1 1, ABC. So one comma 94. So one is the roll number and 94 is the percentage. Now here example number 4 is of default argument. So default value you have to write down as a computer engineering. Okay, and roll number and name, that roll number and name every time whenever you will call the two data. So in two data, for one data you will accept the value as computer engineering, and another value you will pass as information technology. Okay, so computer engineering is a default argument, so it will be already present in your constructor declaration. So in first object you will pass two values, that is for roll number and name. Course will be absent. Course you will not enter any value for computer engineering. Okay, and for second you will change the value of your course as information technology, and you will see whether it is displaying the data or not. Then next, again default argument. So default argument for HRA and DA you have to assign. Class name is employee and basic TADA. So already in most of the learning outcome I have taken the example basic TADA and HRA. Okay, so gross salary is the basic plus TA plus DA plus HRA. So you can take the formula from there and you can calculate the gross salary, but HRA and DA you have to keep as a default values. Okay, so two object you declared, for one object keep the values, write the values in main, and for one object don't write the values in main, and then see what happened. Okay, dear student, the next concept is inheritance. Now what do you mean by inheritance? So inheritance is nothing but we will derive the new class with the help of an existing class. It's called as an inheritance. So the mechanism of deriving the new class from an existing class is called as the inheritance. So this class, in this diagram, class A and class B is given. So we are deriving a class B from class A. So where class A is called as the parent class, super class or base class, and class B is called as the child class, subclass or derived class. Okay, so derived class inherits some or all features of the base class. So derived class having their own features, as well as it can have the features from the base class. But in this case, base class will remain unchanged, and the main advantage of inheritance is the code reusability. So here one more example is there. So in this example, we have base class as well as derived class. Okay, so base class having feature X and feature Y, okay, and derived class having feature A, which is own derived class, defined in the derived class, feature X and Y, which we have taken and inherited from the base class. So if my class is a bird, okay, class is a bird, so, and the derived class is eagle. So eagle will have their own features as well as whatever the common features are there for the birds, that will be in the eagle also. Hello students, in this video we will discuss access specifier, which is used in C++. So there are total three modes of access specifiers, that is public access specifier, protected access specifier, and private access specifier. Now whenever you will derive any class as a public, okay, so in that case you can access all the data members and member functions from you can inherit all the data members and member functions from base class to derived class, but your data members and member function will become private whenever you will derive any class as visibility mode as public. In protected visibility mode, if you want to inherit the value, okay, to the next immediate base class, then we will go for protected access specifier. In protected access specifier, both public members and protected members of the base class will become protected in derived class, okay. And in private access specifier, whatever you will declare in private access specifier, it will become private, okay. Then we can see the syntax of derived class. So syntax of derived class is class, then derived class name, colon, visibility mode, and then base class name. Then here you will declare the body of derived class. Here you will write down the data members. Here you will write down the data members and member function for this particular derived class. Okay. Now in visibility mode, there are total three types of visibility mode: public visibility mode, private visibility mode, and a protected visibility mode. Okay. Generally, we write down the public visibility mode. Now with the help of this table, you will clearly understand that yes, how we can inherit the data members and member functions from base class to the derived class. Okay, on left hand side we have base class member access specifier, means if that base class is declared as public, protected, and private, then what will be the effect? Okay, so if we are inheriting base class members as a public, so you have declared your data members and member function in public access specifier, and if you are inheriting the class as a derived class visibility mode as public, then public and data and inherited visibility mode is public, then your data member and member function will have the visibility mode or access specifier as public. Okay, they will behave as a public visibility mode. If your base class access specifier is public, and if you are inherited with the help of protected, then public data member and member function of base class will become protected. Okay, means what? You can inherit the values from one base class to the another derived class. If you have declared the base class member is in public, and if you are inherited with the private, then public member function and data member of base class will become private. If your base class access specifier is protected, okay, then in public it will in public and protected it will have qualities of protected access specifier, but for private it will have private access specifier quality. And when you will declare it, when you have declared the data members and member function in private access specifier, at that time that private access specifier data member and member function of base class you cannot inherit. Why? Because you cannot access that because it is a hidden. Okay, so total you have three types of visibility mode: public visibility mode, protected visibility mode and private visibility mode. Okay, so if you have declared any member function as a public, then that member function will remain their property same as the public, and it will according to the access, according to the visibility mode, they will change their properties. Okay, so in your inheritance, main focus is on how you are going to derive your base class, or you are derive, how you are going to derive your class from an existing class. So generally we go for the public visibility mode. Okay, thank you. Dear student, in this video we will learn the types of inheritance which is available in C++. There are total 5 types of inheritance available in C++. So first one is your single inheritance, multiple inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, multi-level inheritance and hybrid inheritance. So there are total 5 types of inheritance is available and you can implement in C++. So inheritance is divided into 5 types: single, hierarchical, multi-level, multiple and hybrid. Okay, so one by one we will see the single inheritance. Now in single inheritance means what? There will be only one base class and one derived class if that structure is like this: superclass and subclass. If the structure is like this, so we can say that yes, this program is of a single inheritance. Okay, so you will require only one base class and one derived class. Base class will have their properties and properties and functions and methods, as well as derived class will have their own properties, methods and function, and along with that it can inherit the properties and methods and functions from base class. In hierarchical inheritance we have only one base class but more than one subclass. In this diagram you can see one superclass is there and three subclasses are there. Okay, for example, employee can be manager, employee can be clerk, employee can be worker. In this case the student is from engineering background, so that can be a example of a single inheritance. Then in multi-level inheritance there will be a chain of inheritance. Okay, base class and derived class. For example, super class, so we will inherit subclass with the help of super class. Then we will inherit subclass 2 with the help of subclass 1. So in this case this subclass 1 is called as intermediate base class. For example, student give the test, and based on that test we will have result. But in result what I want the name and roll number from class student, as well as marks of 2 subject from the class test. Then multiple inheritance, we will have more than one base class, so maximum we can have 2 base class, but only one derived class. If this type of structure is available, so that structure or that diagram, we can say this diagram is of multiple inheritance. Then in hybrid inheritance we have more than one type of inheritance is involved in that particular hybrid inheritance. For example, single inheritance and multi-level inheritance, multiple inheritance, combinedly they can make hybrid inheritance. So this is another example of types of inheritance. So in single inheritance we have parent class, and then parent class will inherit new class, derive the new class, that is child. With the help of parent 1 and parent 2 we can derive the new class, that is the child. So here in first diagram, this is the diagram of single inheritance, parent 1 and parent 2, this is the diagram of multiple inheritance. Then in multi-level inheritance, parent, child 1, child 1 1. Okay, so this is the diagram of multi-level inheritance. Then in parent we have child 1, child 2, so hierarchical inheritance. And a hybrid inheritance is nothing but the combination of single inheritance as well as hierarchical inheritance or multiple inheritance. Now in this diagram you can see hierarchical inheritance is there, class A. Class A will derive the two more class, class B and C. Then another example of hierarchical inheritance is class A will derive the three classes, different classes, class B, C and D. Now till now we know that yes, whenever we want to implement the inheritance, at that time we need to create the objects, right, in a void main function. So in case of except hierarchical inheritance, all other inheritance will there we will create the object of only derived class, but in hierarchical inheritance we will create the object of more than one derived class. In first diagram, class B and class C, for both we will create the object. In second diagram, class B, C and D, for these three object, for these three classes we will create the object. Now here is one more diagram is there, that is the combination of single inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, multiple inheritance. How that we will see. See here, class A, class B. Okay, so class A and class B is we are inheriting as a single inheritance, and with the help of class B we are deriving two more classes, class C and class D. So this is the example of hierarchical inheritance. So combiningly we can call it, this is an example of hybrid inheritance. Now in this diagram, again one more diagram is there, class A. Class A, we are inheriting two more classes, class C and class B. This is hierarchical inheritance, and with the help of class C and class B we are deriving one more new class. So this is the example of multiple inheritance. So one more example of single inheritance, that is the base class and derived class. Okay, so base class will have their own properties and methods, derived class will have their own properties and method. So we will inherit some properties and methods from base class to the derived class. Now here we can have class as an animal. Okay, so animal, and we are deriving the new class, that is a dog. Okay, so along with eat and sleep, these are the methods from class animal. We have bark. Okay, dogs barks, right? So this is the an additional property, additional functions of class dog. So ultimately class dog will have properties of base class animal as well as their own functions, that is bark. So it will have total three properties: eat, sleep and bark. Now this is one more example of hierarchical inheritance. Now in this hierarchical inheritance I have class vehicle. Okay, and class vehicle we have derived three classes, class bus, class car, class truck. But class vehicle have their own methods, that is fuel amount, capacity and apply brakes. Okay, but class bus will have fuel amount as and capacity and brakes are different as compared to class bus, class car and class truck. Okay, so this again this is the example of hierarchical inheritance. So total we have five types of inheritance. In summary I can say that five types of inheritance: single inheritance, one base class, one derived class; multiple inheritance, more than two base class, only one derived class; multi-level inheritance, chain of derived class; then hierarchical inheritance, one base class, more than one derived class; and hybrid inheritance, two types of inheritance, mix combination of two types of inheritance, either single hierarchical or multi-level, multiple. Okay, so many combination you can make in hybrid inheritance. Okay, thank you. Dear student, in this video we will learn about single inheritance. So what do you mean by single inheritance? Single inheritance means there will be only one base class and one derived class. Single inheritance in which there is only one base class and one derived class is called a single inheritance. So person is a base class, right, and employee is a derived class. So person is a base class and employee is derived class. What will be the syntax to write down the to implement the single inheritance? So class, base class name, then in that base class we will write down the data member and member function, appropriate data member and member function for this base class, okay? And then after that we will end the class, and when we will start with new class. So class is a keyword, then derived class name, then colon is to derive the inherit the new class, okay, from an existing class. Then visibility mode, so here you can write down visibility mode as public, private and protected, okay. And then base class name, so in base class name we will write down the base class name which is same as written on the in class declaration, okay. Then body of derived class, and then at the last we will create the object for derived class. If we will create the object for base class also, then it will not be useful and we cannot implement our concept, okay, that is single inheritance concept will not get implemented. This is the example of single inheritance, okay. So we have declare a base class furniture having data member as length, width and height. From that derived a class bookshelf having data members as number of shelves. So here base class is furniture, derived class is bookshelf. So first we will write down the data member and member function for base class furniture. Then we will write down the data member and member function for class derived class bookshelf. So class furniture, so in class furniture we have to declare length, width and height. So I have declared in private access specifier, I have declared integer L, W and H. Then in public access specifier we will write down void get data. So void get data will take the value of length and width and height from the user, and void show data will display the value of length, width and height to the user. Here we have end the class, right? So with the help of semicolon, yes, we come to know that key, yes, class get terminated. Now we have to derive the new class. So how you are going to derive the new class? So again, class is a keyword. Then bookshelf, it is a class name. Then colon is specified to derive the new class, okay. And then access specifier, that is public. And then next base class name, furniture, okay. And here we have additional data member as number of shelf. So number of shelf. Now here there are two methods to declare the to access the member function and data member from base class. Okay, so here first method I have implemented, that the base class function I have already called in derived class. So void get data, then furniture, scope resolution operator, get data. So here we are calling the get data member function from base class furniture. Same case with show data, furniture scope resolution operator show data. So we are calling the data member from base class furniture, okay. Now here we have terminated our class, and in void main we have created the two objects, bookshelf b1, so b1.getData and b1.showData. So b1.getData will call first get data member functions, execution will go here, it will execute the get data function from class furniture, then it will execute the show data function from class furniture, and then from class bookshelf. So this will be the output, okay. Now next we have another example, that is identify the type of inheritance and implement it by writing the program for the following figure. Now just observe the figure. In this figure we have two classes, one base class and one derived class. So this is the program of single inheritance, okay. Class name is student, data members are roll number and name. Class, then so this is the base class, and we are deriving the new class, that is the engineering student, and the variable are branch, okay. So total roll number, name and branch. Roll number will be an integer, then name will be in character and branch will be in character. Okay, so in class student we will declare the roll number and name, we will declare the get data and show data member function, and we will accept and display the value, accept and display the value from class a student. Okay, and in class engineering student we have branch as a additional data member, so branch we will take in character. Okay, and in void get data we will call the get data member function from class student, then we will write down enter a branch, okay, and see in branch, so student will enter his or her branch. Okay, and in void show data we will call the show data member function from class student, so it will display the roll number and name, and then it will display the branch. Then class get terminated here. In void main we will create the one object, that is engineering student even, and we will call even.getData and even.showData. So even.getData will call the data members and member functions from class engineering student as well as student, and even.showData will call the show data member function from class engineering student as well as from student. Okay, thank you. Dear student, in this video I will discuss about multi-level inheritance. Now multi-level inheritance is nothing but the chain of inheritance. So base class is there, then with the help of base class we will derive one more class, and with the help of that class we will derive one more class. So this is called as multi-level inheritance. Just see in the syntax, class A, so we have body of base class, then class B. So class B we are inheriting from public A, so class B we are derived from class A, and class C we are derived from class B. Now in this case we will create the object for only last derived class, that is class C. So here we need some values. If you want some values from base class to the derived class, so we need to declare the protected access specifier. Protected access specifier help us to access the value from the immediate base class. Okay, so immediate next derived class we can use the value of your base class data members and member functions. So in this diagram we have three classes, class student, test and result. Class student is there, roll number and name, roll number is integer, name in character. Then void get data function will accept the roll number and name from the user. Void show data will accept the display the roll number and name to the user. Then we have derived one more class that is the class test. So class test we are deriving from the class student. Okay, so class test colon student. So here in marks 1 and marks 2 we have to declare as a protected, because this marks 1 and marks 2 value we have to use when we have to add the two data members, that is marks 1 and a total marks. So we need marks 1 and marks 2, so we will declare the protected. Then void get data we will take the marks of subject 1, subject 2. In show marks we will display the marks to the user, subject 1 and marks 1 and marks 2. Then in class result we are deriving from the class test. So in this case class test is called as intermediate base class, because it is act as a base class as well as derived class. So class result colon public test. So in private access specifier we have declared total marks. Okay, then void display result, so we have total marks is equal to marks 1 plus marks 2. Okay, then we will call the show data member function, then show marks member function. Okay, from the show marks member function, we will call in class result. Okay, then test scope resolution operator show data, it will call the show marks. And then in void main we will call get data and get marks. Okay, and display result. Dear student, in this video we will discuss multiple inheritance and how we can implement multiple inheritance in C++. So the syntax of multiple inheritance is, so the basic idea about multiple inheritance is we have more than one base class and only one derived class. So just look at in the syntax, we have class A, class B. So base class A, base class B, and we have derived the one more class, that is from class A and class B. Okay, so class A, first we have to write down the data members and member functions of class A. Then class B, we will write down the data members and member functions of class B, and then we will inherit one more class, that is class C, with the help of class A and B. So we will write class C colon public A comma public B. Okay. So just in a diagram, so in program you can see we have class employee union. So these are the two independent classes. So class employee will have employee ID, employee name. Void get data function is there and void show data function is there. Get data function will accept ID and name from the user. Show data will display ID and name to the user. Okay. Then in employee union, we have employee union as member ID. Okay, so we will accept the member ID and from the user, and we will display employee ID to the user, and we will derive the one more class, that is the class employee info, with the help of class employee and class employee union. Okay, so we have in class employee union basic salary. So in get data function we will inherit and we will call the base class member function get data from employee as well as employee union. Just see here, employee scope resolution operator get data, employee union scope resolution operator get data, and we will take the basic salary. Same way in show data, we will display first data from the employee and employee union, and then we will display the basic salary. But at the last, in multiple inheritance, we will create the object for the only and only derived class. So your derived class is employee info. Derived class is employee info. So we will create the object for employee info, and we will call the get data member function and show data member function class employee info. So ultimately it will call the data members and member function from class employee and class employee in union. Dear student, in this video we will discuss hierarchical inheritance, how we can implement the hierarchical inheritance in C++. So one example and one syntax of hierarchical inheritance we will see in this video, and we will learn how to implement hierarchical inheritance. So hierarchical inheritance, basically we know that hierarchical inheritance is nothing but there will be only one base class and more than one derived class. So this type of structure is called as hierarchical inheritance. Okay, so you can see in syntax. So in syntax, class A, this is the base class. Okay, after write down the data members and member function for class A, we will terminate our class A. Then we will write down the class, another class. Here I have taken one example, class B colon public A. So this is my first derived class. I will write down the body of derived class. Then I have next, that is the class C public A. So we have another derived class, right? So body of derived class. Okay, so this is the program of hierarchical inheritance. So in this we have total classes: employee, manager and worker. So I have class employee, then class manager and class worker. I have inherited manager and worker from base class as employee. Okay, now here we will see class employee have employee ID and character name. Okay, then we have two member functions, that is get data and show data. Okay, generally we will keep get data and show data member function common in all the three classes. Okay, so void get data, cout enter employee ID, cin employee ID, then enter employee name, cin name. Okay, so in get data function we will take the ID and name from the user. In show data member function we will display ID and name to the user. Then in class manager, we have declared one more class, that is the additional allowance in manager. Okay, so along with ID and name, manager will have their additional allowance. So that may be in terms of money. So in void get data, we will call employee scope resolution operator get data, because we want data for manager, employee ID for manage, ID and name for manager as well as worker. So manager is derived from class employee. Then here void show data, we have employee scope resolution operator show data, means it will call first employee show data function from employee, then it will call their own statements, okay, which is available in manager show data. Then in class worker, we have float over salary, overtime salary. So in overtime salary, it is applicable for worker. So again, we will take the we will call the get data member function from employee, and then we will take the overtime salary, same case with show data. But when you will create the object in main function, at that time we have to create the two objects, for manager separate object and for worker separate object. So manager M1 and worker W1. So M1 dot get data, it will call the employee get data, employee show data, manager get data, manager show data. And in worker get data and show data, it will display the employee show data and get data, as well as worker show data and get data. You can have the look on this output. Okay, manager name is Dinesh and worker name is Nitin. Okay, employee ID for manager is 123, employee ID for Dinesh is 234. Overtime salary for Nitin is 300 and over additional allowance for Dinesh is 5000. Okay, thank you. Dear student, in this video, we will discuss about virtual base class, which is used in C++. So virtual class basically is an example of hybrid inheritance. So in this diagram, you can see that yes, there is one grandparent class, then parent 1, parent 2 and child. Okay, so total we have three different types of inheritance involved in this diagram. So first inheritance is grandparent, parent 1, parent 2. Okay, then parent 1, parent 2, child. And grandparent, parent 1, child, grandparent, parent 2, child. So these are the three different types of inheritance. So hierarchical inheritance, grandparent, parent 1, parent 2, multi-level inheritance, grandparent, parent 1, child, grandparent, parent 2, child, and multi-level inheritance, parent 1, parent 2, child. Now, the main focus to learn virtual base class is now that if there can be a situation like this, so we have that there can be a duplication of inherited members due to this multiple paths. Now, which are the two independent paths? So you can inherit the traits and characteristics, methods and properties from grandparent to child via parent 1 and parent 2. Okay, so child class inherit the traits of grandparent via two separate paths. So here child class could have duplicate sets of inherited members from grandparents, okay, through parent 1 and to parent 2. So to avoid this, we will make parent 1, we will derive the parent 1 and parent 2 as a virtual. So when we will derive the parent 1 and parent 2 as a virtual, then we will have only one copy of that particular grandparent member function and data member will get inherited, okay. But for that we need to write down the virtual keyword before your visibility mode. So this is the basic idea about virtual base class.